Hi, family. How's everybody doing tonight? Great to see everyone come out tonight to get a portion of God's Word. First and foremost, I'd like to thank our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, amen, for making this all possible for us. I'd like to thank the pastor for allowing me to share and the gifts he gives, the Lord gives me. All right, why don't we bow our heads for a word of prayer and we'll stand and sing a couple of songs. Dear Heavenly Father, Abba, we come before your throne of grace, Lord, grateful and thankful that we can gather together tonight, Lord, in safety to learn about you and to worship you and honor and glorify your holy name, Lord. Thank you for all your generous provisions that you provided to meet each and every need today, Lord. I pray for the people that are sick, Lord, that you touch and heal their bodies, Lord, and bring them back to wholeness and completeness, Lord. We pray for our nation, that it be guided in godly direction, Lord, through your word and the principles of the Bible, like the nation was founded, Lord. And let everything we do tonight, Lord, be led by your spirit and not our flesh. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, if we can stand, we'll sing a couple songs and get started.
Into your side. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day. My daily bread, your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate. And I'm lost without you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me.
Very last two things that it was saying in that song, I'm desperate for you and I'm lost without you. You think about going through the course of a day when you're in this world and like you start to get desperate for the Lord, say, Lord, I'm lost without you. Amen. It's just so beautiful that those songs, they can hit the very core of you. What a beautiful day it was today, huh? It was raining and the sun came out. A little taste of spring is in the air. You know, if we only get through a few more weeks, right? Without that white stuff, I'm going to be home free, right? Because once it gets to March, if it snows a little bit, it just melts right away. So, all right, we're going to continue on our study in spiritual warfare and how to fight it. This will be the fourth segment and final segment of it. We'll just go over a few things by way of review. But before that, just turn your Bible to Ephesians chapter 6. Hold your finger there. We're definitely in a battle in this world, okay? We might not see it. Well, we might. We might forget it's there. But the enemy would love nothing more, okay, than to fill our minds with discouragement and defeat. And I can't stress that enough, because I know as walking as a Christian and trying to walk as salt in this dark world, salt and light in this dark world, Satan tries to hit us with discouragement and defeat all the time. And he wants us to see all the failures that we're having instead of all the victories that we're having. And there's many, many victories, because just that thought of that battle that we're having is a victory, because before we didn't even try to fight that. You know, we just fell into it. So it's too often we get through busy, we race through busy days, this mind myself, ill-equipped, unprepared, or simply not aware what we're up against or who the real enemy even is. We have to understand that it's not the people, places, and things that is the enemy. It's Satan. It's what's behind it, okay? We have to understand that, and we have to look at it through spiritual eyes, with spiritual discernment, and we have to always have the armor of God on. Talk about this all the time, but it's something that we really need to have on when these adversaries and adversities come into our lives. Otherwise, this doesn't have any benefit for us. We just fail miserably. We have to have the armor on constantly. Okay? Spiritual warfare is not giving the devil more attention or focusing too much on his evil ways. Okay? There are many ways that we might be fighting spiritual battles. I don't know about you, but now, I woke up this morning and wasn't feeling very well. And I'm like crawling out of bed. You know, my throat started scratching. And the first thing I was like, oh, I just want to stay home. And then if I would have did that, then I probably wouldn't have been able to come here. Because the more that I sit and wallow in that, the sicker I get. So you know what? God's going to get me through the day. I'm just going to go. And as I got up and started moving around, praying and doing the things that I normally do, I started to feel a little bit better. But if I was just focusing on not feeling good, it would have just dragged me right down into that depressive state. You know that, oh, here we go. Sick again. But no, God gives me the power. He gives us all the power, all right? All right, let's just go over a couple of things that we might be going through. Number one that we talked about is sudden or extreme onslaught of various troubles, losses, and trials. See, we think that a spiritual attack is something outwardly. You know, we get spiritually attacked inwardly in our thought process, okay? Then it comes out outwardly. We see everything outwardly because we're thinking with the enemy's thoughts, so it comes out outwardly and we see everything negative. But we have to understand that it's the devil putting thoughts into our heads and making us act on them thoughts. The devil didn't make us do it, but he makes us think of things that are bothering us and things that are troubles and, oh my God, what a busy day it's going to be. But you know how it goes. And then we start going off. And then all these things start building up. The second one I talked about was attacks of physical danger, illness, life-threatening loss. Like, I'm saying, okay, I don't feel good. Could that be an attack? Absolutely. Why wouldn't it be? The devil tries to attack us in any way. If he can't get me with doctrine, and he can't get me with my faithfulness to the ministry, he'll try to get me with sickness so I can't make it. So he's trying to find the weakest point. He's trying to find my weakest point and attacking that weakest point to stop me from fulfilling God's purpose in my life. And he tries to do that to you too. He tried to hit us at our weakest point. He knows that he can't get us with doctrine because we're really doctrinally sound. We read the Bible. We study the Bible. That's the core of our belief. So to know the devil can't get us in that way. So he goes to after, he picks at other things. What other things aggravate you? You know, neighbors, neighborhood, job, boss. So he tries to get us at things that he knows what irks us. So he tries to go after those things and cause problems. Those are attacks from the enemy, okay? We don't see the enemy coming, but we get this thought process going and say, wow, the devil's definitely attacking my thoughts. And you know what? I don't want to fall into that attack. So that's why God gives us plenty of ammunition, which is the whole armor of God, to what? Fight off all these schemes of the devil. But we have to know that it's the devil. But one other thing we have to understand, the devil doesn't make us do it. He tempts us, but we carry out, we make the choice to do it. And we know we got this sinful nature and this flesh, and the devil just loves to get our flesh to come out, doesn't he? Doesn't he? Oh, you know, you tell everybody, you know, I love the Lord, right? And the next minute, something vile comes out of your mouth, or something, you get aggravated real easy, and the devil's like, see? Yeah, you love the Lord, but you also love your flesh too. Amen? I understand that. The third one I talked about, increased temptation and luring towards sin or wrong choices. The devil can get us at this point of being tired, not feeling good, right? Discouraged, you don't see the church film, you get discouraged, you have, oh, is this walk, is this really the right walk? Because why isn't, well, if you go back in the days of Noah, there was only 8 people that were actually on key with God. So you have to understand that even Christians fall prey to the attacks of the enemy and fall into that, and that's why all I know is I need this as part of my armor. Whenever the opportunity arises for me to get into the Word of God, I do it whether I want to or not. Even if I fight against it, my flesh might war against it, but I know it's going to be good for me to get here. Actually, I made a good choice by coming here on a Friday night, and so did you. Because you know we made some bad choices on Friday nights in the past, correct? So we made a good choice. That's good. Okay, so the fourth one, feelings of overwhelming despair, darkness, and fear. Did you ever get gripped by fear? I mean, it is so, I can't tell you how fearful it is to walk out of there and come up to here after the devil tries to throw confusion and thoughts into my head to try to trip me up. See, fear paralyzes us, and it stops people from fulfilling God's plan for their lives. Because they're afraid that they might trip up or fail. So fear grips us. You ever get gripped by, oh, I get gripped by fear all the time. But Jesus came so we don't have to wallow in that fear or be fearful. I'm just so grateful. Even though it's fearful, God says, you come, my spirit is going to take over. You have to trust me. You have to trust me. This is where trust and faith come. Faith, you know, you believe something, but the trust that you have to actually go through the fear, get into the courage of the word, and then come and do it and overcome your fear. But you have to actually do it. Or else your fear will always get you, and most people won't end up serving God because they think that they're going to fail somehow, or I'm not that good at anything. No, we're not that good at anything in the flesh, but in the spirit, we're so powerful. And we can do so many things for God. And these things build your faith and strengthen you. This strengthens me. Every time I come and give a message or come up here, it strengthens my faith in it. I have to trust God more and more to get me through it. Amen? This is what we do. So that was the fifth one. Deep confusion, feelings of condemnation and guilt, dulled spiritual awareness. How about, have you ever gotten up and just not even felt spiritual at all and just got into the world system again, just like you used to before? You get up, you're aggravated, the coffee maker ain't working right, nothing's good, you forget to pray. It's just like it never happened, like you never had it. It's just like gone. You get up and you do your routine, and then your awareness, your spiritual awareness is so dull because you don't have your armor on. As soon as you go out, everything's a problem. And nothing, instead of understanding that God put me out there tonight, today, to put me on a mission, to test me, to get me strong, and to help somebody, we're all wrapped up in ourselves and our selfish ways all over again, and forget it. We don't even see anything spiritual. We see it all, what, carnal. And then we use carnal weapons to fight it, like an eye for an eye, talking about and doing the whole things that the world would do to solve these problems. But God has a battle plan for us, okay? When facing spiritual warfare, we have to understand that we can't fight this in our flesh, okay? We have to understand that. So let's go to Ephesians 6:10, and let's read that, and then we'll get into God's battle plan. I'm going to read down to, we're going to keep going. Finally, my brethren, Apostle Paul, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Just those words alone. Being strong in the Lord is being strong in the word. Because when you're in the Lord, you're in the word. So you're strong in the word. And guess what? And in the power of his might. The power is in the word. So we have to be strong in the word, and the power is in the word. The power of his might, of his word, is what empowers us to face these spiritual battles, okay? Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Think about it, the wiles of the devil. The devil's really sneaky. He puts us in these tempting situations where, I'm not really sure if the Bible calls that sin or not. And then we try to like justify things and trying to tune out, the devil just tries to get us on the fence with something. And then we fall into his trap. He's very, very sneaky. He's like the fisherman. Like I said, when he wants a certain, catch a certain fish, he throws a certain bait on. He knows the bait that catches you. And he throws it on every day. And listen, the more you start walking towards the Spirit and with God, the more bait and lures he's going to throw at you. Okay, this lure isn't working anymore. Let's try this other one. Get it? That you haven't been working on. Get it? I'm going to hit you with another temptation that you think was gone. Saying, you know what? I haven't done this in a long time and I haven't really been bothered by it. Be careful. Be proud. Don't get proud about it. Say, you know, unless we what, fall. Because the devil is just waiting for us to think that we got something under control. So no, we don't have anything under control. He has it under control. See, we're depending on him. We end up taking credit and say, well, I got control. So I don't have to worry about this anymore. And then, boom. He comes and hits us again. Thinking that we got our hands, we're done with it and dealt with it. It's not coming back. And boom, it comes back because we don't have our armor on. All right, look what it says. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Now, we have to understand this is something that is very hard for believers to understand as we go out in this world. When somebody comes at us, we're not wrestling against flesh and blood enemies. Satan is behind that, okay? So we have to understand that we don't fight back to them. We pray for them, the Bible says. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. I'm saying, oof. Talk about. Gives me the eebie-jeebies. Spiritual wickedness in high places. It's like, how do I fight that? And most people don't see it because they're under control of the devil, and they think they're just living normal. But we know that there's something behind that. And we're not to what? Handle it. You can't fight back in the flesh. You know, I'm going to let them know. And I'm going to tell them off. And I'm going to let them have it. And I'm going to tell them. That's the way the world handles things. We don't handle things that way anymore. And when you do, the spirit, you don't have no spirit. The spirit's not there. The flesh is there. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Amen. Now look what it says. Wherefore, take unto you, verse 13, the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day. Oh, man. and having done all to stand. I don't know about you, but I don't like to, I'm done, I don't like to fail. I don't like to fail. I don't want to fail the Lord. I want to be successful in my Christian walk, don't you? Well, there's a way that we can be. Because if we're constantly failing all the time, we're constantly going to say, hey, you know what, this isn't working. I just, my foot. No, there is a battle plan, okay? There is a battle plan, but that battle plan has to come out of here, but it has to become part of who you are. You have to be part of the battle plan. That's why it says, be strong in the Lord and the power against his might. I don't know about you, but I'm reading through the Bible again. And I'm getting a better understanding of the scriptures as I keep reading it. How about you? Even though some days slips my mind, don't want to get in there, God always sends the reminder out. Right? I'll get a scripture or something will come on the phone or something. Oh, yeah. I got to read my daily walk today. You see how we can forget? But when we're in real trouble, we don't forget any of that stuff. You know, we go, oh man, I'm getting on my knees. I'm praying, boy, this is hard. So the first thing we talk about in God's battle plan is the gift of the Holy Spirit, okay? We talked about this before. We're gonna talk on these seven key things that he equips us with, okay? God fills us with strength, wisdom, and discernment through his own spirit to stay strong in the battle, okay? We need to stay strong in the battle. This, you ever get into a battle and it's not over in 5 minutes? We wish it would be. The battle goes on and on and on. You might get a victory in the morning, but guess what? Here comes the afternoon battle now. Right? And then here comes the evening battle, and here comes the end of the week battle where you're tired from working all day, okay, all week. You're hungry. Things ain't happening. And that hit you at the weakest point when you were strong all week, but that one day, boom, all bets are off, and here comes the flesh all over again, and we get defeated. There's a way that we don't have to get defeated even then. We have to know what our weaknesses are, what to stay away from, and who we have to talk to. Jesus, okay? We have to go to Jesus. The more and more as I grow in my Christian life, the more and more I'm going to Jesus and not to John's ways. Get what I'm trying to say? I think that I have the answers. I talk to people all the time that think that whatever they're telling you is the right thing. I'm saying, how do you know what you're saying is right? How do you know that your answers are the right things? Only God knows the right things and the right answers. I'm starting to understand that you know what? I could be wrong. Well, that knocks down our pride, right? I could be wrong. But one thing that's never wrong is the truth of God's word. If you're going by that, then you can't be wrong, okay? You understand that it's an attack from the devil. I'm going to pray. I'm going to keep my mouth shut. I'm not going to revile back. I'm going to trust what the God's word tells me, that that's not the reality this is. That's how we fight back. But if we don't have all this in here, we fight back like this, with worldly weapons. You can't fight a spiritual battle with worldly weapons. It doesn't work. It leaves us what? Weak, frustrated, and defeated. Let's go to Acts 1, verse 8. So, it says here, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you. So the minute that you believe in Jesus Christ, guess what comes upon you? The Holy Ghost. So you are receiving the power of God at that moment in you. Now, that takes a while to get what? Developed in you, but it's there. There's no question about it. You believe in Jesus Christ, you have the Holy Spirit, and you have the power of the Holy Spirit that resides inside you. Thank you, Jesus. And that's not a feeling, it's a fact. And thank God it's not a feeling. Because I don't always feel the Holy Spirit. I don't know about you. But one thing I know for sure, the Holy Spirit is in me. Amen. And I have the power of that Spirit that raised Lazarus, that raised Jesus. I have all of that part of the Red Sea. I have that power residing inside of me. Okay? I have to use that power to fight against what? Principalities and powers in this evil world. I can't use the, I can't, my flesh can't handle it. Now it says, after the Holy Ghost comes upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all of Judea and in Samaria and to uttermost parts of the world, of the earth. We're his witness. I don't know about you, but what would be the witness for me? I mean, I said, well, I can't explain what happened to me. I just, something happened. You can't quite explain it. Just like it says in John, you don't understand how the wind blows, just like you can't understand how you receive the Spirit. You can't understand it, but I'm at Bible study on a Friday night in 2019 where I can't even fathom in my mind that I would ever be here. Okay, that's how something took over me. Thank God it did, amen. And something took over you because you're here too, right? Hallelujah, praise the Lord, knowing that we have the Spirit in me, because I know the worldly spirit in me used to bring me, okay? And it wasn't to church. Okay? I don't have to go any further with that, right? But I have to remember that force that I gave to the devil is still in me. That flesh, I still have that sin nature in me that has, at any given time, can fall back into it. Because I already gave parts of my soul over to Satan. So he knows my weaknesses, and he knows what I like. He knows what my flesh likes, and he knows what your flesh likes too. You know, when we get desperate and in despair and things ain't going our way, automatically we look for something of the flesh to give us some comfort, something that we can do to ease our pain and burden. So we go to something that always try to fill something in us, but that doesn't work. We keep going to it because it's familiar. It's a tangible thing that helps us. Oh, I'm just going to go shopping. I'm just going to go do this. I'm just going to go do that. Instead of just saying, I'm just going to trust Jesus, I'm just going to work through this battle, okay? I'm going to pray. I'm going to go to prayer. I'm going to call one of my brothers and sisters and talk to them about these things that I'm going through so I don't have to fall prey to them. See, we have to learn how to use each other. You know, most people won't get on the phone or talk to anybody that's going through something. They'll try to fight it on their own and fail. And then nobody knows what's going on. And I can't read anybody's mind. I don't know what's going on in your life when you're not in church. Amen? That's part of the armor. Gathering with the saints is part of the armor, trust me. Coming here tonight is part of the armor. I know tomorrow is going to bring enough problems. And this is going to equip me to handle tomorrow. Okay? Now let's go to Romans 8:26 quick. The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. Look at verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself make it intercession for us with groanings that can't be uttered. You know, help me. I don't even know. Just help me. We can't even explain. We can't even, like, talk to God about it because we can't explain it. It's just help me. I don't know what it is. I don't know what's making me angry. I don't know what's making me irritable. But, Lord, help me. I can't. I don't know what it is. And we just talked about the armor of God, right? We went there already, Ephesians 6:11-17. We have to put that on. God reminds us not to go into the day without being prepared and equipped for battle, okay? He tells us to take up his full armor in order to stand against the enemy's schemes. Each piece has a specific purpose and is designed for our protection and covering. You know when they put the armor on? You know, you ever watch the knights when they put their armor on? They make sure everything's covered. All their vital organs are covered. They got their helmet. So any kind of attack, they can what? Withstand it. Look, you can't just go read in one scripture and think that your full armor is on when you go out there. Boy, I wish it was that easy, huh? Jesus loves me. Okay, I'm going about my day. I got the armor on. Yeah, Jesus loves me, but the devil hates me. And he's going to do everything he can to what? Find a chink in my armor. Get that one spot that I'm not doing, that I'm not strong in. I'm not getting strong in. Just to get in that little spot, just to pierce me and get me. That's why we have to find, it's always good to find what your weaknesses are and evaluate yourself, where you're at in your life. Say, well, where's the devil tripping me up every day? You know, a lot of us try to blame, you know, work, the devil, this, that, but we have to find out where our weaknesses are. Where's the chink in my armor? Why am I letting that bother me? Why am I letting that situation irritate me? What's going on with me? It's so easy to find out what's going on with the world. We know the people are doing all kinds. Look, you'd have to leave the whole world to think that everything's going to be right when you go out tonight, when you leave here. We have to find out, why am I not able to handle this certain situation that trips me up every day? What is wrong? What is getting me? I have to check myself before I... Exactly. Usually, first, no, we wreck ourselves, then we check ourselves. Does it have to be that way? No. Because the devil doesn't hit us with a full frontal attack. He hits us with the little irritants. Picks at us, you know, like pick, 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 pick. Finally, it's like, ouch. You know, you get irritated when, you know, somebody at work is just looking, doing their own thing, selfish, or somebody's looking to take your place, or whatever. You know how the world goes, to one up on somebody and throw you down or talk about you, and then that weakens us. So, you try to read the Bible, and then you try to go to work, and, you know, the car doesn't start, or you get a phone call, you know, you were supposed to do this, why didn't you do it? And then you start getting... You know, you held out pretty good at work, and then here comes the phone call, and here comes the drive, and here comes everything else. And okay, that, you worked out okay, but I'm going to hit you somewhere else now. I'm going to get you, and I'm going to get you, and I'm going to keep picking at you till you finally explode. And I'm like, no. Pick all you want. I'm not exploding. I'm finding myself maybe getting picked at 6 times instead of 2 to explode. So I'm getting better. Right? I'm not perfect, but I know that I'm making progress because I'm not letting things like right away hit me. I'm withstanding some of the attacks and they're lasting long. I'm withstanding them longer, and then I'm falling later on. So now that I know that I have to check and see where the weaknesses are, and I have to get stronger in the Word and in actually applying what the Bible's saying. That's just my walk. I don't know about you, unless you're real perfect. I'm making progress, though. How about you? See, we always see what's wrong. See, I'm making progress. See, like I said, instead of falling after 2 issues, I'm falling after 6. So that's a victory for me. See, when we look at where we fell, instead of how long it took us to fall that time, we're making progress. We're getting stronger in the Lord and the power of His might. See, it's progress, not perfection. Right away, we come to the Lord and say, no, this is the way it is. I'm supposed to be just like Jesus now. I'm going to go out into that world, and I'm going to be a representative of Him, and I'm going to do this. And God says, you can't do nothing without me. Apart from me, you can do nothing. What are you talking about? Go ahead, try it. Get it? The third one is prayer, okay? I know for me, okay, one of my weaknesses is my prayer life. Why do I say that? Because sometimes I try to say to myself, well, God already knows. Why do I have to pray? God already knows. I prayed once. Well, how do I got to keep praying about it? And God says, no, pray without ceasing. Continually pray. I'm saying, okay, I'm getting better there. I'm starting to pray more without ceasing. But I'm not perfect. You see? But I'm making progress. All of us sitting here tonight are making progress, whether you want to see it or not. You are. Okay? We're all making progress. God invites us to have a relationship with Him. He desires for us to spend time in His presence, pressing in to know Him more. Now, how do you get in His presence? I don't know about you, but I like listening to a meditation or a song. Also, it's not just the Word. There's other things that are available through a song or a meditation that helps us to what? Get in His presence. Like when we were singing them songs, I felt that connection coming through the song. It ushers in the Spirit for us. All right. He reminds us constantly in His Word of the importance of prayer and the power that is found there. He tells us to pray without ceasing. And even when we don't know what to say, He tells us that the Spirit intercedes for us. What is the whole point? The whole point is, I'm going to God. You see? It's the point of, I want to pray. I want to talk to God. Even though you don't know what to say or anything, God acknowledges that you want to talk to Him. You see? That's the whole thing that matters. That brings us into a connection with Him, whether you feel it or not. You see, I want to talk to God. That's big. I want to talk to God today. And I don't know what to say, but I want to talk to Him. Even if you don't know what to say, the Spirit intercedes for us. What does it mean? Well, when you go there and you kneel down or whatever you do, or however there's no certain way to do it. I just happen to try to get quiet and kneel down and talk to Him and pray. And sometimes I draw a blank. How about you? But the Bible says the Spirit intercedes on my behalf. The Spirit knows what I'm thinking, even though that I don't know what I'm thinking. The Spirit knows what's in my heart. That's awesome. So why am I going to not go there? I have to go there. The Bible tells me that's one of my weapons. That's one of my... prayer is powerful. So if my prayer life is stagnant, then there's a weakness there in my armor. We get it? Tells us the Spirit intercedes for us. He never leaves us to fend for ourselves in a dark world, but reminds us that He's constantly with us fighting for us. Ephesians 6:18. These are probably still in the book, right? Look what it says. Praying always. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. And watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Or, in other words, pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. What does it mean by praying in the Spirit? People get all this is not some creepy, crazy thing, praying in the Spirit. No, you already have the Spirit of God. Praying in the Spirit is saying, I'm just trusting God. And I'm going to go pray to Him. That's praying in the Spirit of God because you want to connect with God. It's not something that's, you know, it's real. Let's put it that way. God wants to have a real relationship with you. Amen, right? It's a real deal. It's like God wants to know, you know, you can talk to God saying, you know, hey, my foot hurts, Lord. Or, I don't really want to do that today, Lord. And he wants to just talk to you. He wants to know the real you. You see, when you talk to God with your true heart is when He's really listening. Okay? Lord, I don't really like what's happening to me, but I know that You know best. I'm trusting You, Lord. But I don't like it. What's wrong with saying that? God already knows that you don't like it. Don't think you can hide from God with some lofty prayer and saying, well, I already know what's in your heart. I don't know about you, but my relationship with God is real. Okay? When I need to talk to God, I talk to Him. Say, Lord, listen, here it is. I'm spilling it out to You. You told me that I could. You want to have a relationship with me. Here it is. Here it is. And guess what? Nobody else is around when I'm talking to God. And I talk audibly to him. And I let him know what's going on inside of me. And usually it takes a point of pain for me to get to that point. And God's saying, you don't have to go to a point of pain. You can pray to me when you're having victories too, you know. And thank me. I'm saying, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that I kept my mouth shut at the right time today. Thank you, Lord, that I didn't open my big mouth. Look at James 5:16. Let's go there. Now, it says something really interesting. We just studied the book of James. It was good, wasn't it? But it says something very interesting in James 5:16. Confess your faults to one another and pray for one another that ye may be healed. You see it? Talking about your failures with your brothers and sisters helps to heal us. See what it says? Confess your faults to one another and pray for one another. Hey, listen. Call them. Hey, listen, I'm going through a hard time today. I really feel like giving up. Get it? It puts us back into it again. A lot of us do not use that. Everything's hush hush. Look, whatever's hush hush in your life has power in your life. Whatever you're hush hushing about, oh, I don't want people to know what's really going on with me, has power over you. It's still controlling you because you can't get it out. You want to save your face and not say anything. But there's other brothers and sisters that you can trust that you walk with. God puts them in your life so you can be real with them and talk what's really. You know you can't say it to everybody because they'll, you know. But there's brothers and sisters you can talk to that God puts close in your life that you could pour your heart out to. And God uses other people. You're sick as your secrets. You really are. A lot of people, shh, shh. What's going on? Oh, everything's going great when your life is falling apart. Listen, we come to church because our life is falling apart. This is a hospital for sick people. How can you come to church and say you're not sick? You're lying. We're all sick. And we need a savior. And it's about time people say, hey, you know what? I'm sick. I need help. Please help me. I'm here to get help. I'm having failures in my thought process. I'm angry. I'm bitter. I got resentment. I'm talking about people. Help me. I'm just going to shh. And people get clicky and they get this and they ignore other people and they act in the flesh. And it's like, wait a minute here. Is Jesus in the house or isn't he? Or is he knocking on the door saying, you going to let me in? As far as I understand, church is for what? People to heal. Because people that aren't sick don't need a doctor. We come to church because we need Dr. Jesus, okay? That's why we come to church. So if we come to church, oh, everything's doing so good. There's no, that's not Christianity. I don't know about you, my day was hard today. And I'm glad I'm in church because I need this. This is my lifeline. I am not turning to drugs and pills and alcohol and sex and all these things that are going to try to make me feel better after my week. I'm going to trust God and I'm going to hang in there till he comes through because he said he would. We want instant fixes. I just have a condition. Yeah, you have a sin nature. Of course, we all have a condition. I am not going to the world for a fix. I'm going to the Word and I'm trusting Jesus. He's going to get me through this mess. Can I get an amen for that? Now I'm starting to feel a little bit better. Because that's the truth of the matter. Even Christians go to the world to get fixed. Wait a minute. He's the one who fixed me. The world could not fix me. I came to the foot of the cross and he fixed me. And he's the only one that's going to continue to fix this broken condition that I have called sin. Look what it says. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. We're all righteous in Christ, but let me tell you something. When you're living God's way and you're living the right way, your prayers are more powerful than somebody that's just living for the devil. Trust me. So if you want your prayers to get answered, say, well, why my prayers ain't getting answered? I have to check myself and saying, well, maybe because I'm not living up to what God would want me to live up to, and I'm just going to pray to him, just like the people did in Israel. They were living like the devil and going to worship in the temple. The fourth thing we have is word. He arms us with the sword of the Spirit, the word of God, to stand against the enemy's lies. How many times does the devil throw lies at us? You say you're saved, huh? Look what you just did. Look how you just acted. How can you tell me that you have Jesus in you? Lies. It had nothing to do with my behavior to get saved. It had everything to do with what I believe. And we have to fight the devil with Scripture. Praying God's words back to him is a powerful weapon against the forces of evil, right? We have to what? Jesus was tempted out in the wilderness, right? He fought the devil with Scripture. He didn't fight him with worldly weapons. He fought him with Scripture. For it is written. God did not give me a spirit of fear and timidity, but power, love, and a sound mind. When my mind's full of scrambled eggs, it's an attack. Because God said he gave me a sound mind. And if I'm polluting my mind with other things, it's not going to be sound. And the world tries to do everything to what cloud this. Whatever it can use to cloud it, it could be anything, right? We get obsessed with all kinds of crazy things to cloud this mind. The Bible tells us to be sober and vigilant. So we have to be what? Totally aware. There's things that cloud my mind. Like the devil. He's always like throwing that dark cloud over my head. Instead of the sun shining in my mind, he's trying to throw a dark cloud over, saying, this Christian life is too hard. You can't do this. Come back over here. Remember how easy it was? And I'm like, I can't remember it being that easy. Living a big lie. It's even harder to live a lie than being a Christian. I'm all set with that. You know what? The truth will set you free. Amen? Are you with me so far? Okay, so far. Look at Hebrews 4:12. We got, we're gonna be able to finish this tonight. This is good, okay? God's word guards our hearts and focuses our minds back on him. Look at Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. God cuts through all the chase, okay? He knows why you're doing it, how you're doing it, without anybody else. God knows the intentions of why you're doing what you're doing. Okay? God knows. The word knows. So powerful. What else? 2 Timothy 3:16. Come on. Stay with me now. I'm like, I can't hide from God. Okay? Neither can you. And guess what? You can't hide from the devil either. All Scripture, look at this, is given by inspiration of God. Now people will tell you, oh, that Bible's written by people. Yeah, it was written by people who were inspired by God to write it. Duh. The Bible doesn't talk about how good people are. The Bible tells how bad people are. So it wasn't written out of any inspiration but from God. He was telling how bad the human condition is. You read the Bible, what we actually do. Our heart is wicked and deceitful above all else. Who will really know? So why would I write that about myself? right? In the human condition, we want to write about our achievements and accomplishments and how good we are. The Bible shows failure in human condition, so you know it's from God. Very simple. That doesn't take rocket science to figure that out. And it's profitable, look at it, for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. The Bible instructs us how to live right, okay? We know how to live wrong. You don't have to tell a little kid how to do the wrong thing. They automatically already know it, okay? We have to be taught how to do the right thing in the wrong situation, in the wrong world. We need to be taught how to act right while we're here in this world. And the Bible teaches us how to do it. Trust and obey, for there is no better way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. I trust God's word. How do I show my trust? By obeying what it says. That shows how much I trust God. I trust God shows up by my obedience to what he says in his word. Do I have faith? Yes, but my faith has to turn into a trust where I become obedient because I trust what the word of God says over the situations in my life. Amen? All right, the fifth principle, the power of praise, okay? Praising God is powerful, something that we sometimes forget to do. We would like to say, oh, praise the Lord when things are going well. But praising the Lord when all hell's breaking loose loosens hell's grip on you. Because it's like the slap in the devil's face saying, you're praising God after I'm putting you through all this? I'm out of here. Because that's a testimony right there. Praise invites God's presence, okay? He dwells close to us when we praise him. And praise is a powerful weapon as well, okay? It makes the enemy flee. It pushes back the darkness that surrounds and blocks the attacks and the hissing lies over us. Okay, so here comes the attack. I'm just going to praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for allowing me to wake up today. I love you, Lord. You see, that's what makes the enemy flee. When the enemy's winning the attack and you're not praying, you know what? A lot of people, when things ain't going right, we ain't praying. We ain't praising God when things are bad in our lives. We ain't praising him. He puts the good and he puts the bad in our lives. He wants us to what, praise him because he's taken us through everything. I'm learning to do that now. I'm learning to be thankful, not just at supper time, okay? I'm learning to be thankful when I was getting ungrateful at work, saying I deserve better. And I'm saying, no, you deserve judgment, the Bible says. You better be thankful you got that job because there's somebody ready to take it. Don't worry. Don't think you can't be replaced because you can be. You get off your high horse. You can be replaced. And you will be. And I'm like, all right, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for putting me through this situation. It's only going to teach me a good lesson. I need a good lesson right now to keep my mouth shut and be thankful that I can go to work and provide for my family. You see? That attitude, what? Breaks the chains of the devil. And then next thing you know, work is going good. Everything starts ebb and flowing like it's supposed to. But we have to what? Trust God. Amen? Evil will not stick around if we're praising our God who will fight our battles for us. In the story of Jehoshaphat, we see God miraculously defeat the enemy because of the people's obedience to praise him. Go to 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Look what it says here. Look at verse 21. And when he had consulted with the people, he appointed singers unto the Lord, and that should praise the beauty of holiness, as they went out before the army, and to say, praise the Lord, for his mercy endureth forever. And when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord set ambushes against the children, see it, children of Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, which were come against Judah, and they were smitten. They were praising God, and they were knowing they were going into war. And they were thanking him and praising him. And guess what? God fought the battle and defeated him. Get it? Wow. Those scriptures are written for our example. To praise God as you're going into this battle in your life. You're going through a battle, say, at home. You know the home battles, right? Thank you, Jesus. Have mercy on me. I love you, Lord. And guess what? That will definitely create a diversion in your life. If you repay evil back with evil at home, don't worry, it's coming. But when you pay back evil with good, it will definitely praise the Lord. You know what? When you mention Jesus, thank you, Jesus. That'll smooth it right over. But no, what do? We start complaining and grumbling at home. Jesus' name not even said. It might be said in the wrong way. Get an amen for that. Listen, when we praise God, he fights the battle for us. Listen, victory is mine, saith the Lord. I will repay. Don't worry. If, you know, whoever's, I'm not going to pick on anybody. And who's ever given you issues, God will take care of them. Don't worry. Give him the keys. He's working. Calms the storm. But when we don't give God the keys, the storm doesn't get calm. The storm gets what? Fire against fire, fire against fire. Next thing you know, you've got an inferno going on. Sometimes it comes to what? Physical. You know, you start breaking things and showing your anger instead of what? Trusting God. Praising God. Right when you're ready to hit that storm. Try it sometime. Right when you're ready to that storm to come out. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. It'll push back the enemy, trust me. It's like, where's the devil's gotta go? Look, do we do this though? Here's the thing. I'm teaching you this, right? Do you do this when you go home? Do you do this when you're at work? Do you do this with other people? Are you just sitting here letting it go in one ear and out the other? Or are you really absorbing it and saying, you know what, I'm going to try that. Tomorrow when I get up and somebody comes at me, I'm just going to thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Let him fight the battle. Isn't it easier to let him fight it for you? Just imagine they're telling you, okay, you've got to go to war. But you don't have to fight. What would you choose? Would you choose to grab the gun and get shot in the head? Or would you rather sit there and watch someone else fight for you? So you don't get shot in the head. Listen, it's the same thing with our spiritual attack. We don't want to get shot in the head with spiritual attacks. We want to let the Lord take it. That's what he said, give your burdens to me. That's what he means. It's powerful. He inhabits the praises of his people. Psalm 22, verse 3. Let's go there. One more. Psalm of David. Psalm 22, verse 3. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Let me tell you something about God. He's worthy of praise, okay? Whatever your situation is. Because let me tell you something. He saved you. You know, whatever the situation is, he's going to get you through it. And he promised that he would if you just trust him. The whole thing of the Bible is unbelief and lack of trust in God that makes people fail. And not waiting on the Lord. Waiting on the Lord. I'm going to keep my mouth shut. I'm going to let the Holy Spirit guide my words. Remember what King David, put a guard over my mouth. I need more than that. I need a zipper. Every time it wants to come out, the Bible says to say something good. Say something good and edifying instead. Or else am I coming to church, learning all this stuff, and just doing whatever I want and doing and not changing? There's no transformation. Just a bunch of information. No, I'm going to wake up tomorrow and praise the Lord no matter what's going on in my life. If all hell's breaking loose, the only way to get the hell to break loose from my life is to praise and worship God, the Bible says. And he'll take me through when he sees fit. All right. Obedience to Christ, sixth principle. Our willingness to obey the words and commandments of Christ in a world that would say to walk our own way is huge. Okay? Listen. It sets a powerful example that says that we are willing to die to our own desires and live for the glory of God. But it will never happen naturally. Okay? You can't do that naturally in the flesh. Our very flesh, our own desires, and sin nature will fight against it every step of the way. You understand when the battle comes that your flesh wants to fight it. But you have to what? Subdue it and say, no, I'm not going to let my flesh fight it. I'm going to let the Lord fight it. I'm going to be obedient to Christ. Look what it says. It's a daily choice that says we will be careful of every thought, okay? And we will take up our cross daily and follow Christ's ways, not our own. Submit to God's authority. Be ruthless with sin, which is an open door for the enemy to work. Resist him, and he has to flee. See, sin opens the door for the enemy. Once you start sinning, the doors are open to the enemy. James 4:7. Submit yourself, therefore, to God, okay? First, we have to go into submission. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. See it? What do we have to do? We have to submit to the authority of God first, and then resist. See, we resist through the power of Christ, not ourselves. Then he has to flee. All right, 2 Corinthians 10:4-5. Let's keep moving here so we can get done with this. Verse 5. 2 Corinthians 10:4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or worldly. See it? But mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. What's a stronghold? Something that fills our mind that's not truth. It's a stronghold that we think is truth, but it's a lie. It's a stronghold that the devil has built up in our thinking system and our thought process. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God. Now, there's a world system out there that thinks they know how to handle things better than God does. There's a world system out there that says we can do this better than God can. This is what it's saying here. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, the knowledge of God's word. The world says you don't need the knowledge of God. You need the knowledge of the world to get through the world. Now look what it says. In bringing into captivity, thinking about this now, every thought to the obedience of Christ. Imagine to bring our thoughts into obedience to God's word, our thought process. My stinking thinking has to be cast down into the obedience. Say, nope, that's not God's thoughts. Those are not God's thoughts. I have to what? Put them, I have to give them to the Lord. I have to bring them into captivity. That's not the right thinking. That's something I have to do. I am not thinking properly right now. I have to think like God would think in this situation. What's the obedience of Christ? Obedience of the Word of God. The seventh one, the blood of Christ and the word of our testimony. Revelation 12:11. Let's get through this. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. What did they overcome them with? The blood. See it?
And by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death.
They loved the Lord more than they loved their own life. Okay?
They overcame him with the blood of the Lamb.
When we belong to Christ, the enemy never has a final word over our lives, okay?
This is a closer.
We are secure in God's hands. Do you realize,
God, you're always secure in Christ.
You are in the most secure place you could be as a believer.
You are secure in Christ.
Heaven is your home. You can never fall out of God's hands. You might fall into temptation, but you can never fall out of his hands. He loves you. He's never going to leave you nor forsake you. He's with you every step of the way. He ain't going nowhere.
Thank you, Jesus, right?
Press on, courageous and free, never held back by fear or defeat. The battle belongs to the Lord, and he has the final victory, amen? Victory is in Jesus, amen? There is no victory in self, amen? All right, that's the end of this message. Thank you for letting me share that with you, and we're going to close with a word of prayer. Thank you.
Thank you. Hang in there, soldiers. Dear Lord, thank you, Lord, for fighting our battles for us, Lord, when we give it to you, Lord. Thank you for always being there for us, Lord. Thank you for always being faithful to us, Lord, even when we're not faithful to you. Thank you for loving us unconditionally, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for pleading our case, Lord, always. Thank you for saving us, Lord. Thank you for equipping us for the battles as we face in life, Lord. Help us to be living examples of you, living through us, Lord, by being obedient to your word and trusting you more and more, Lord, and less of ourselves. And I pray that everyone finds you, and you reassure each and every one of us that you never leave us nor forsake us, and you're with us every step of the way, Lord. And we all arrive safely at our destination. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great night. Hope to see you soon. I will have these notes available, too, if you want them.